All right, so I'm here today with Dwayne Mullins, who is a good friend and is a local farmer's agent here in Brentwood. And Dwayne, you've been in the business for how long?
35 years.
35 years in the business. Dwayne's been my personal farmer's agent for 20 years. Mm-hmm. I think it's gonna be this March that we moved to Brentwood 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so I can't recommend Dwayne highly enough. 20 years ago, do you remember this? In March or April, whenever it was, we closed on the house and I drove the moving truck from Colorado and pulled up in the driveway. I didn't know anybody in Brentwood. Dwayne showed up and started helping unload the truck and lifting furniture and boxes. And so thank you.
You're welcome.
If I never thanked you for that. And also, you know, again, over 20 years, every time I've called, needed advice or help, at one point with four teenage drivers in the house, I appreciate all of your advice and help and willing to talk through policies and concerns and coverages and all those things.
Yeah, absolutely. It's easy for me to do. I at the same time had young teen drivers. So not only am I, you know, an agent, I know where the consumer is coming from, especially when they have concerns with youthful driving and issues that unfortunately revolve around youthful driving.
Yeah,
so.
Well, we never had any
no
any claims there.
No, you were good there.
Gratefully. But what I'm talking about today is issues that we're having and seeing in the real estate space, because things have definitely changed. Mm-hmm. And I know that homeowners insurance, right, as part of that process, when we find a house and we go through escrow, perform our inspections, and we get our loan approved and we're ready to close. Mm-hmm. It used to be one of the last things that we did was, hey, you've got a closing condition prior to funding. You need to call the insurance agent and get a quote and have them send it over to the title company. So that we can finalize and close escrow. And we'd call you up and give you a couple details on the property and you could send that over to escrow mm-hmm. pretty quickly. That's not happening anymore.
No, those days are gone. In fact, we used to get calls from the title company, people that actually signing off and didn't have their insurance, and we could get a policy to them in 5 minutes if need be. If we had all the property information, their information, it was point and click. And those days are gone, unfortunately.
There's we're running into, I'm actually seeing closings that are getting delayed mm-hmm. Because we can't get, or it's taking so long to get homeowners insurance. Why is that? Mm-hmm. What has changed over the last couple of years that's created this?
Well, the biggest driving component to all this mess is all the fires that we've had in California. It really started like 5 or 6 years ago, and the numbers are finally hitting the books. And unfortunately, there are a lot of major carriers that have pulled out of the state of California. So those of us that are left, they've tightened up underwriting guidelines. And there's other things that are out of our control, such as fire line scores, which are determined by FEMA. They come up with a score based on tree density, fire services, road accessibility, slope and grade, and a million of other factors. And they come up with this score. Well, based on the score, an insurance carrier can say, okay, we have, you know, we'll take a tolerance up to a certain score. Above that, you have to have the California Fair Plan. They call it a DIC, which is difference in condition. We call it a Fair Plan endorsement policy. But industry-wide, it's known as a DIC. And Fair Plan, unfortunately, they have been absolutely inundated. They're bombarded. And what used to take, I could submit a quote in the morning for a quote, have the approval by noon. It's taking 2-3 weeks. We have some in queue right now that have been there over a month. We're still waiting for approval.
Wow.
And there's no way to expedite.
And Fair Plan, that used to be, I mean, that's been around for a couple of years now, but I thought of it as for our cabins up in Tahoe and
right.
homes up in the mountains, but that's not the case anymore?
No, it's affected all areas of fire line scores. I mean, some areas you wouldn't even think about. Oakland Hills, obviously, with the fires we had way back in the early 90s,
sure.
That was a lesson for the insurance carriers. But there are a lot of areas, Moraga, Lafayette, Orinda. You get into some of the other areas, such as, as soon as you hit the foothills, it becomes a problem. But there are other areas here in the Bay Area that are affected by that have high tree density around properties and maybe narrow roads or steep sloping grades where it's difficult for fire services to get in there, and what should be a kitchen fire is now a total burn down. So they're looking at this from, and they're taking these Google Earth photos and they're looking at a canopy shot of a home absolutely, you know, canopied by trees, and the homeowner wants to know why their insurance has gone up substantially or they can't get it if they're a new buyer.
And do you expect this to change? What do you, how long are we going to be in this kind of a environment?
You know, I went to a seminar in Dallas about 6 months ago, and there was a lot of people there that are in the know from the corporate side, and some economists that were thinking about, okay, what would it take to get out of this mess? And honestly, there's no real solid definitive answer. 2026, yeah, it's going to be back to normal. I don't think it's ever going to be back to what we perceived as normal. There will be a new normal, unfortunately. I think if we go, based on everything that I've heard from the industry leaders, that if we go another couple years without having any major catastrophes, catastrophic fires, or water losses. We got hit real heavy last year. I mean, they used to be called storms. Now they're atmospheric rivers. I mean, that's a new phrase, but it's obviously it's a pain point for the insurance world. So we have to go a few years unscathed. Our company lost hundreds of millions of dollars negative the past couple years, approaching the $2 billion mark. And carriers simply can't absorb that. Luckily, Farmers, we're a large company. We've been around forever. And we're a California-based company, so we're not leaving the state. However, we have tightened up the underwriting guidelines with large carriers such as State Farm shutting the doors to home insurance and a lot of the other carriers doing the same, big carriers. We were afraid that we would have this flood of policies that would come in and then we would be overexposed. So they really tightened up and limited some things that we can write. But we have solutions when it comes to that. So we can talk about that further when you're ready.
Because you're writing outside of Farmers.
We are. I have to give Farmers first right of refusal. If they say, hey, you know, we don't want this for various reasons, I'm able to take it outside. We are brokers, so we can do what we have to do for our clients, do what's best, shop it around. You know, when this mess first started, we had several carriers that it was really easy to get quotes. And now that pool of carriers is starting to shut down or close up. So we're down to a handful. But we have carriers that we know that are very solvent. They're A and best rated companies, A or better. We have admitted and non-admitted carriers, and we can get into that whole admitted, non-admitted debate. But there are carriers that can get your insurers or your new home buyers protected.
Okay. And so then if it's different, at what point should we be calling you and requesting that quote? I mean, we go out, mm-hmm. we look at the properties, we find something we like, we're going to write on. We've got to the point where those disclosure packages are usually available ahead of time. Mm-hmm. And a lot of buyers are writing without an inspection contingency. Can we call you even at that point to find out if this home is going to be insurable or what the rate is going to be?
Yeah, you can call, but unless you have an accepted offer and you're ready to really get things going, I wouldn't recommend doing so because obviously underwriting guidelines are changing. It's fluid. Things are changing daily. Okay, what are the new guidelines? So we would hate to get something quoted out there and then all of a sudden it's no longer an acceptable risk or I have to take it to another carrier. So yeah, we can do it. Obviously, within 30 days, we can guarantee that if we quote it, that, okay. that number will stick. But anything beyond the 30-day envelope, it's going to be, you know, okay, hopefully things haven't changed by the time you do close escrow.
Okay, so we need to get the house into contract.
Correct.
Again, you don't want us to go through the inspection period and wait until loan docs are coming. We need to, during our investigation,
correct.
Inspection contingency period,
right.
be contacting you and requesting that quote so that we know what the cost is going to be and that the home is going to be insurable.
Yeah, or if we have to have multiple policies. Again, if we have to have just a Farmer's policy or another outside carrier's policy that I write with, that's fine. But as soon as we have to get California Fair Plan involved in this quoting process to complete the application and get this property insured, again, we have no way of expediting. We email and we text and chat, and we just simply can't get through. They are absolutely bombarded. So 2 weeks is a minimum. I haven't seen anything faster than 2 weeks, and we're seeing over a month now getting approval, waiting for approval. Yeah. And these are the ones we're waiting for. These are brand new homes. So you would think that would fly right through, and they're just not. So.
And what about pricing in general overall? How much of rates would you say in the last 3 or 4 years increased? Are we up 10%? Are we up 50%?
In some areas, 100%.
Wow.
It just depends on where it's at. If you're talking about up in my area, 100%. In the foothills where it's, you know, the fire services aren't quite what they are here in the Bay Area. The road accessibility, the slope and grade, all that stuff comes into play. And rates have really jumped up. You know, and here's the other thing. Back in the day when I first started, you know, 35 years ago, $250, $500 was a common deductible. Everyone had that. That's what you thought you should have, and no one wanted to be out of pocket for more than that. And these days, we're recommending high deductibles. And when I mean high, I'm talking $5,000 to $10,000 deductible. And people go, oh my God. Well, it shouldn't be viewed as a maintenance program for your home. The fence is falling over. It's 25 years old. Let's just have an insurance claim. That those are homeowners. Unfortunately, the joys of being a homeowner, you have to pay for things sometimes. Right. It can't be things wear and tear. You can't turn those items in anymore. I wouldn't recommend it. And by doing so, by carrying this higher deductible, you're saving so much money. The average homeowner, and this is not a farmer's average, or this is an industry average nationwide, the average homeowner has a claim once in every 11 years. So it just makes good dollar sense to carry that high deductible. And if you go the averages, you know, if you do, Lord forbid, have a claim, you're going to save the additional money that you've saved all along in premium dollars, annual premiums, to pay more than make up for that higher deductible than you normally would carry.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. Are there any other questions I should ask you?
Well, you know, I think you've hit on the pain points of the industry right now. You know, whereas before now, we're getting calls from lenders wanting to know, you know, it's a condition of close of escrow. They can't even get into escrow unless they know that this property is insurable. You know, I highly recommend too, especially on older properties, to make sure that the electrical has been updated. The one thing that we're seeing out there now too are, one recommendation I have from an insurance standpoint to realtors is if you have a client that's in contract on a home, see what the house history is. Make sure there's not any claims. If so, what was the claim? When was it paid? And what was done to mitigate further damage? If it was a water loss, if it was a fire or wind loss, whatever it might be. And get the receipts, paid receipts from the seller showing that it was done, the work was done by a licensed contractor. So we have one going right now. They're being set up for a non-renewal we can't get them insured. There's a new purchase because the house had prior claims. The other carrier from the seller, they were being non-renewed, but they're selling the homestead, so they don't care. Yeah. But the new insurance carrier, they want to make sure that this place has been fixed, and it was a roof leak, and it was a big roof. It was an old tar and gravel roof and the guy went up there and basically patched it. So that's not going to be easily insured. In fact, he may have a real problem getting that property insured because it wasn't done by a licensed contractor. He had his friend go up who used to work for a roofing contractor, went up and did the repair work. He's going to have a licensed contractor go out there and sign off on the work before we can get it insured.
And the solution might end up being a whole new roof.
That's correct.
On a house like that, which
that's correct.
You know, we get into a negotiation over a seller credit.
Yes, absolutely. And use that to your buying power because it is an issue. We're also seeing, you know, carriers are doing the earth, you know, the Google Earth photos, and they're doing overviews saying, okay, this roof has, you know, the inspector came out and said it has 20 years left, and we see where there's shingles missing, you know. So it's very, insurance carriers are definitely scrutinizing things very heavy. So due diligence, get inspections, obviously beforehand before you make that offer, because if it's a $20,000, $30,000, $50,000 roof,
yeah,
it might change the whole deal.
Yeah, and it's important then, again, how we talk to our sellers
sure.
and make sure that they understand the questions in the disclosure package
yeah.
about prior claims.
Exactly.
And that they're disclosing properly so that we don't end up with a buyer that has an issue halfway through an escrow.
Yeah, and we're seeing it right now, and we're dealing with it right now. So hopefully we're going to get a contractor to go out and look at this particular roof and sign off on the work that was done. Hopefully that will be the case, and they can move forward with escrow. If not, I don't know that they want to replace the roof.
Yeah. Good.
So those are the two things. Get in front of it. If it's going to be a California Fair Plan, DIC, or endorsement policy, as Farmers calls it. And the old days of 5-minute, call me, we can get you insured, they're gone for now. I don't see a timeline on this, a minimum of a couple more years of this, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
So that's
great advice. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you.
Glad we could help, and hopefully some of your listeners out there will take heed to this, because it really is, and it's not a farmer's, it's an industry-wide issue. There's a carrier down the hall, major carrier down the hallway, and they're having more problems than we are right now, and they're sending policies our way because they're stuck, and they're trying to service their clients as best they can. So
they're one of the ones that I thought was pulling out of California.
Correct.
Are they not issuing, are they not writing any new policies?
Well, that particular carrier, you're in great hands, They haven't had a home policy in a long time. Okay. They've been writing through other carriers. They still have other carriers they write through, but like everybody else, they're pulling out. So they have limited resources right now. And they're not alone. Again, there's big carriers, State Farm being the largest, that said, no, we're not writing homeowners in California.
Yeah, that was a big deal when that came out. Do these issues affect our other insurance policies? Is this why my car insurance is going up? Does it affect life insurance rates? What's the impact of these losses over the last several years on the other policies?
Well, the one policy line that hasn't been affected is life insurance. That has had no bearing on the rates, or hasn't had an effect on life insurance rates. But they're separate. They're their own. They have their own loss runs or loss figures that they look at. What has affected car rates in California is litigation costs. It's gone through the roof.
Okay.
And we're not seeing any end of that. Insurance carriers buy insurance, called reinsurance. And in the past 4 to 5 years, our reinsurance has quadrupled in price. So they're going to pass that on to the consumer, unfortunately. The claims have just been overwhelming in California. California is a very litigious state, so therefore our auto rates have gone through the roof.
I know you can't drive a quarter of a mile on I-5 in Southern California without one of these big billboards, right? Have you been hurt in a crash? You know,
it's insane. Since we moved up to Copperopolis, we get all Sacramento channels, news channels, and I go to the gym every morning, and I swear to you, every commercial is a different law firm, and they, you know, they work on a contingency fee basis, and basically the consumer says, well, if I get hit, I'm going to sue. I have nothing to lose. If they win their case, then the attorney gets, you know, a big chunk of that. Yeah. If they don't, well, then nothing out of pocket. So,
and at a minimum, the insurance company has to defend themselves.
We have to defend it. And our defense costs have gone through the roof in the past 3 or 4 years. So auto rates have been affected in California big time. Certain areas worse than others. But the areas out here, you know, used to get out of Tri-Valley, and insurance, auto insurance rates used to be dirt cheap. But unfortunately, and what we did, our rates were super high in San Francisco and Oakland and Berkeley and those, you know, high density areas where claims were real high and a lot of uninsured motorists and blah, blah, blah. Well, then all of a sudden it trended the other way. Their claims started going down. So we were able to reduce premiums in those areas. But the bigger claims started happening out in the more rural areas, the higher bodily injury claims and more litigation involved. So, I used to say, oh my God, if you live in San Francisco, your insurance auto rates are going to be, you know, through the roof. Well, they're kind of hand in hand with what's going on all over the Bay Area right now and in the outlying areas. But I would have to say auto rates are predominantly driven by overall costs and litigation. And let's face it, body shops, I mean, the parts, everything's gone up. You know, now with electric cars, the replacement parts on those things are very expensive. The labor rates on some of these other vehicles are super high because it takes a specialist to work on that. Well, that cost gets passed on to us as a carrier. We get the right to check for that. So there's a lot of components to that, but I would say litigation is number one. Everything else is just overall cost of doing business in California.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
So that's it. But now on life insurance, rates haven't been affected. Give us a call. We have great products.
Yeah. And that's the most important one to have.
You know, it really is. People are so concerned about their auto policy or their home insurance. As well, they should be. But what they need to be concerned with, more importantly, is the source of income. And if, Lord forbid, if something happened to you, your income's gone. You know, or if something happened to C, her income's gone. The household's expenses still continue.
Yeah.
So we want to make sure that money-making machine, which happens to be you and I, we're protecting our families, Lord forbid something happens to us.
Yeah, and we were talking about that. We're at the age where, you know, we've both been personally affected.
Yes.
Losses that we didn't expect, people we didn't think would be gone.
Yeah.
And, if a family gets left in a situation where, you know, I don't want my wife to have to do a GoFundMe to cover funeral expenses, it's worth paying that. You know, like you said, the premium on the life insurance is still reasonable, and it's worth having.
It is, and there's products for everybody. I mean, certain things are going to fit certain situations, and we have those products, and we can sit down and go over what your goals are, and that's important. You need to know what your primary objective is to make sure your wife doesn't have to sell her home and the kids get uprooted from their schools and things of that nature. So those are our key components to have when we come up with, okay, this is how much life insurance you should have, what kind of program best fits your needs. And that's what we do. So yeah, it's unfortunately when at the demise of somebody or a death, everyone has their hand out. Funeral expenses, the mortgage is still due, things are still, the bills don't stop.
Right.
And I like to think that we provide a service that can allow people, it's bad enough they've lost a loved one and they're grieving, but to have financial burdens on top of that is unbearable. Yeah. And I've seen it happen this past year. So I would love to talk to anyone who has questions or concerns about that.
Yeah, good.
All right.
I know.
We did it.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you, Tom.
Appreciate it.